Well, now I have the clicker of power and we are ready to go. Unless you're going to do the clicking for me. All right. Well, ironically, the idea for this speech started with something I hate. Mustard. I don't like the taste. I'm not fond of the color. And part of that goes back to bad childhood memories, when my brothers would chase me around the house trying to stuff mustard pretzels into my mouth. The mustard bottle in my fridge right now is only there out of politeness for guests. I don't eat it, if at all possible. However, I can't or won't avoid the subject of mustard today, because a mustard seed is where my story begins. You have to have faith as small as a mustard seed. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. You see, those of you who know me well know that faith is part of everyday life. But I get to passages like this and think, what? Two things stand out to me here. First, mountains, they don't move. At least they don't without an earthquake. They're huge, strong, immobile. They've been in place for millennia, and I'm a puny human, placed on this earth for a number of years, and that's it. Second, mustard seed. It seems small, but in the context of power to move mountains, even faith as small as a mustard seed feels unattainable. So what is Jesus talking about here? Why does this simple statement cause us to freeze in our tracks? First off, I don't think he was referring to physical mountains. The geological formations in my hometown are fine where they are. But life is full of obstacles. Cultural barriers, social anxiety, personal and spiritual and emotional battles. They tower over us as unforgiving and immobile as any mountain, causing our faith and hope to fail us. That brings me to the mustard seed. Jesus chose it for comparison because it was the smallest seed used commonly by farmers at the time. I think he was making a statement that faith is not about quantity, but about quality. It's not about quantity, it's about quality. I am small and puny. I am no match for mountains, whether physical or symbolic. If I rely on myself, nothing's going to move. If I kind of rely on God, but don't really trust him to do things, nothing's going to move. But if I totally place my faith in the God who created mountains, remembering that he's bigger than anything I come up against, well, then I'm off to a good start. But it's only the beginning. James, who happens to be the brother of Jesus, writes, "Faith without action is dead." I think he was making a statement that faith is not a... Oh, sorry. Skip down. I can sit on my own thinking positive thoughts about trying to counterbalance the mountains in my life. But positive thoughts aren't action. I can shake my fist at God crying out, why did you allow this mountain in my life? Or God, please move this mountain. But sitting and pleading is not action. So any faith I claim to have is dead unless it causes me to move. Here's the hardest part. A seed on its own does nothing. Seeds are designed for growth. Yet on their own, they remain hard, hiding inside their protected shell, useless. Unless a kernel of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Ouch. If I have faith, but it doesn't lead to action, then my faith is dead. Yet in order for my faith to move me to action, I must be willing to risk life itself. That brings me to the question, do I have enough faith to be willing to die in order that change can occur? You see, seeds are designed for growth, but that doesn't mean that all seeds produce growth. I remember taking seeds from my apple core as a kid, digging a hole in my front yard, watering it day after day, week after week. Carrie's laughing because she probably did the same thing. Yep. And nothing came up out of the ground. The seed was there, but it was useless. Action that brings change is risky. When facing a mountain, I feel safer staying within my protective shell. I may be alone, but with tough skin, I can fend for myself. Dying to self, on the other hand, means my insides will be exposed, leaving me vulnerable. Take a look at this video of a seed doing just that. Turn the volume up. As the seed grows, its shell is broken, tossed aside and forgotten. The scrawny green plant that sprouts could easily be trampled on or destroyed. However, it doesn't stay that way for long. At the end of the video, did you notice the bark of the larger oak tree in the background? The seed we watched grow is the fruit of that larger tree. An average oak tree can produce 70,000 to 150,000 acorns in 1 year. If even one-third of those acorns become trees of their own, the expansion rate is exponential. In other words, one seed dying and growing into one tree can have a ripple effect that carries over into generations. Let's bring this home. What does dying to self look like for me and you? Or what can one person do to produce fruit that will spill over into future generations? History is full of average people whose simple acts of faith created a ripple effect on their community or culture. Most of those people did not physically die in order to produce change. However, they were willing to risk, or at the very least, they risked comfort, reputation, and time. Martin Luther King Jr. says it well. Faith is taking the first step when you don't see the whole staircase. This man's actions were peaceful in a turbulent time. He was a peaceful man, but he couldn't stand aside and ignore the gigantic issues around him. He had faith that men could put aside racial hatred and discrimination to live with the equality that America's government had promised but not enforced. Towards the end of his famous "I Have a Dream" speech, he states, "With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood." Martin Luther King was one of many civil rights activists who were willing to take the first step toward cultural change, even though they couldn't see the whole staircase. These individual sacrifices were part of a much-needed avalanche that began to move the mountains of racial discrimination in our United States. Rosa Parks, what did she do? She simply sat. She refused to get up, and she allowed herself to become arrested for refusing to get up. 1 year later, buses were desegregated. Sit-ins happened at over 60 cities in the South. So that finally restaurants and other areas were desegregated. And 6-year-old Ruby Bridges, you don't have to be old to make a difference. 6-year-old Ruby Bridges was escorted by U.S. Marshals to and from elementary school as desegregation began to be enforced. 3 years later, Norman Rockwell painted this illustration for Look magazine. Norman Rockwell, a very white, illustrator who had a decade-long, many decades-long career with, now I'm blanking on the name, Saturday Evening Post, thank you. As the art teacher, I know it, but it went. With the Saturday Evening Post, he had worked for decades, and he left them behind to go to Look magazine because he knew that things like what was happening with Ruby Bridges needed to be shown to the public. Here's some of the fruit of Martin, Rosa, and Ruby. These people you don't know, but this is my Uncle Jeff, and that is our friend Keith, one of my mom's best friends from high school, 40 years later, still a good friend. This is him with his son. And that relationship would never have been possible without the desegregation of their high school. Jeff was bused to one school and Keith was bused back to mom's school. And these should look familiar. One of my favorite things of working at Waubonsie is the diversity here. If you have friends whose skin color is different from yours, you can thank people like Martin, Rosa, and Ruby. But maybe your battle has nothing to do with civil rights. Perhaps you relate better to the simple life and helping our environment. Take a lesson from a man in history who became known in legend as Johnny Appleseed. John Chapman was a businessman who lived from 1774 to 1845. He would gather seeds from cider mills, plant them, grow the seedlings, and then sell those apple seeds for 6 cents each to people who wanted to settle in the wilds of Ohio and Indiana. Seems so wild now, right? But back then, if you wanted to prove to the government that you were serious about claiming land, the best way to do that was to have an orchard, a pear orchard or an apple orchard. So Johnny Appleseed, or John Chapman, actually spent his life walking through the wilds of Indiana and Ohio selling apple seedlings so that people could plant and settle the areas of Indiana, Ohio. So he walked thousands of miles in his lifetime back and forth across those states. He ended up owning 1,200 acres himself, even though he gave most of his money away through the years. He was still a fairly wealthy man. And he definitely didn't dress it or look like it. He did walk barefoot. He would often exchange seedlings for clothing items from people who were too poor to give money. But that's how he dedicated his life. The simple act of growing seedlings and giving them to people so that they could settle land. And that is Indiana and Ohio around the time of Johnny Appleseed. So by the end of his life, he had gained the nickname Johnny Appleseed. While he had never married, he had several siblings whose descendants are around today. In fact, a good friend of mine from high school, Carolyn, is a descendant of Johnny Appleseed, or John Chapman. His name survives in legend, but the fruit of his life is scattered over apple orchards throughout the Midwest. One last thought to leave you with. The man Jesus who first made this statement put his faith into action by dying on a cross. The life he lived, the death he died, and his victory over death caused shockwaves that are still felt today. People in nearly every nation, culture, and language have studied his teachings and taken steps of faith to live by his example. Some of those people have given their very lives to follow him. Their faith in him gave them the courage to face mountains and command them to move. Where will your faith take you? Will it take you out of your shell and away from focus on yourself? The journey may be risky, but the fruit is worth it in the end. Thank you.